right after we pointed all those horrible things out, we'll get the recording started for the VOD. I have got Cosmo ready. Are we ready to get rolling? You guys, like,
yeah,
in your character?
It.
You center?
Yeah.
All right, let me take a quick... Holy shit, that was actually... All right.
Well, now I'm not in character.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Welcome to the Wednesday Bang Bang! I'm your cosmic caterer, Cosmo! Let me recap the last week. Jeremy T. Bear, a sentient bear and technical wizard, took the bridge of the Ark and met their partner, Mickey Mickelson, at the same time. Together, they are tasked with scattering the Federation's most dangerous relics across the known universe and beyond. Last week, they chucked the last known dragon's egg into the spaghettification field of a black hole, all while avoiding the threat of space pirates and the universe's literal manifestation of bad luck. Can our new heroes continue to face such odds? Well, they showed up for the show tonight, so probably. But let's find out together on Cosmo's Cosmic Bang Bang! Cosmo's Cosmic Bang Bang is filmed in front of a live studio audience. Live Twitch audience. How you guys doing?
Since the last time you asked me, my life has taken a big downward spiral.
No, sorry. I'm asking Mickey and Jeremy now. I don't... Not Abe and Connor.
Since the last time you asked me, my life has taken a big downward spiral.
All right. So, Mickey, since the end of the last one, you have had time to sit down for the first time and go over your personal effects. Your cell phone, I guess, your personal communique, you notice has messages for just pending messages. They're all from the same person named Yaz. Y-A-Z. Yaz tells you that every message is Mickey? Mickey, what happened to you? Call me ASAP. Mickey, are you alright? Yaz was your best friend in your assignment. You know Yaz is not exactly a go-getter, where you were put in that position as a punishment. Yaz volunteered to be in that position. But they were your closest friend previously.
I was just really hoping that every message was like, opportunity for you to $100. Click this link now.
We've tried contacting you about your car's extended warranty.
If you want to.
So all I have is a message saying Yaz saying, Mickey, what happened to you?
It's a bunch of messages from Yaz trying to get in contact with you, asking you to call them.
Oh, I'm just going to send a message back that says, sup.
Okay. You don't get a response. The last message was sent probably, we'll say, an hour before you checked it. And it said, give me a call.
I know. I guess I look back and I noticed that message I hadn't seen before when I said, sup. And I said, all right. That's kind of rude of me, I guess, and I give Yaz a call.
Straight to voicemail.
I leave a voicemail that says, sup.
Sup. How'd you get the train? My stream cut out.
Yeah, I also got prompted.
The train happens because you guys participated in the train. So, like, when a lot of stuff happens at once, like, a high train will start trying to get more people to do stuff. So, okay, so you ring up Yaz on your phone, and Yaz, they answer like, is this Mickey?
Yes.
Mickey, it's me. Yaz, where have you been?
Delivering stuff. I'm a delivery driver.
So you're alive. What do you mean delivery driver? You were supposed to, you didn't show up for work, and then they fired you, and then, well, I guess they reassigned you. But then when I went to go look where you were reassigned, all of your information's been deleted from the database, man. It's like you never existed in the first place.
That's interesting, Yaz. I don't know why that would be.
I don't... Mickey, are you okay? If you're into some stuff, man, you could tell me. Like, if it's gambling debt, we can work together. We'll start that business we were always talking about, the surfboard shop. We could do that.
Oh, yeah. I have a couple more jobs to do, but I still would love to do that, Yaz. I just don't know if I'm supposed to talk about my job or not.
Mickey, I'm not sure you're doing all right. You know you could tell me anything. It's not like I'm going to tell anyone.
Yaz, are you doing all right? You're acting really weird right now.
Mickey, you were my only friend, and then you left without saying goodbye.
Yeah, but you know, that just be Mickey. Mickey being Mickey.
All right, Mickey, if I literally mean that little to you, I guess then I will, I won't see you again. And Yaz
what?
Hangs up.
Oh. Well. Huh. Glad to be rid of him, I guess.
Crosses a name off a list.
One name. It's just Yaz, and I cross it off.
Jeremy, not necessarily at the same time, but at a different time in between missions, you are returning to your dormitory doing whatever Jeremy T-Bear does on the ship at the late night hours without Mickey. When you are returning to your room, you enter the area with the 8 doors. You see the steward standing in front of Cal's room, which is where you B&E'd to previously. The steward is standing there with her arm extended towards the door, frozen.
Well, this door is right across from my door.
I think it's right next to it. I think you took 2.
I took 2. Okay. I was imagining it goes like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Like a hotel. But no, if it's right next door, I'll still walk up to her and just imagine that she needs a little bit of an oiling. I'll give her a quick checkup.
She rusts like the Tin Man. Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, you never
blah,
know.
Blah, blah, blah. As soon as you go to approach her, like, as soon as she senses you are there, she kind of comes back up and says, "All the dormitories are clear. We are ready for the new captains."
I think we're already here.
There is, she doesn't respond. She's a robot, so there's no like visual. You don't see anything that makes you think she received that, and then she just floats away.
Hey, Stuart?
Yes.
Why were you pointing at that door just now? What's going on in there?
That room should be unoccupied. I just came through the laser wall on the way to the mess.
Oh, but you were like frozen, pointing at it.
I don't think that's true, Jeremy. You're always telling such funny jokes.
I have literally never told a joke in my entire life.
Floats away.
Fuck it. He's gonna walk in and he's gonna type in the code and unlock it and check and see if there's anything in there.
It's unchanged. The room has definitely not been cleared out. But it is not different than any time the last time you were here. Excuse
me. Well, and just shuts it back up.
Great. Cool. When you awake the next day, the tone letting you know that a new delivery is ready pings over the intercom. Yeah.
Well, time to get to work.
Mickey would like to show up like 30 minutes late.
So you okay?
you make a conscious decision to show up 30 minutes late.
The loud tone that can only mean do the job you're only here to do. I'm gonna ignore it for 30 minutes.
No, it's more like he like rolled over and like tried to sleep a little bit longer, but it was really loud, so he couldn't wake up, and he ends up being like 30 minutes later than everyone else.
All right, so Jeremy gets on the bridge with the steward. Commander Edmonds is there and says, "Hello, Jeremy." I cannot remember Edmonds' voice. "Hello, Jeremy." "Hello." We'll go with this. "Hello, Jeremy. Where is Mickey?"
I don't know. I don't keep logs on him. Isn't that kind of your job?
I would think it's more accurately Blake's job. Blake, where is Mickey? Oh, Mickey is taking a little snooze. I'll increase the volume of that alarm just to see if we can't get him up here a little faster. Alrighty.
Right as Blake says that, Mickey kind of like bursts through the doors and he's like, "Morning, everyone."
It worked. Edmund says, "Thank you for joining us, Mickey. It is a pleasure, as always, to see you again."
To see you, too.
If you guys want to get started on this one, it should be relatively quick.
They always are, aren't they?
He didn't mean to sound that ominous. So the button on the pedestal is glowing.
Let's touch it.
Mickey waltzes up before as he did the first time and slams down that button.
As you push, the pad comes out and your new delivery. And Edmund says, well, if you won't be needing me on this one, I will see you when you're done.
Well, we've never really had you, per se.
Oh, I'm just a phone call away.
Yeah.
Jeremy's not too good with phones.
Jeremy,
you pause.
Jeremy, you crack me up again with the humor. All right, guys, good luck on this delivery. Click.
All right, Jeremy, you ready to get this done?
I don't think we really have a choice.
I mean, sure you do.
Nope.
I try to not go.
You need me to show you how to use Space Deed?
Excuse me?
It's a lovely website where you can find a bunch of different job applications if you don't want to work here, Jeremy.
How exactly would you suggest that I get out of this one?
I mean, you can apply and wait for an interview.
Yeah, but that would still involve me trying to find a way to leave this job.
Hmm.
And I don't think we just get to leave.
Have you asked?
I mean, yeah, Jeremy, I did. Is there something in the contract you read that I didn't?
Well, I called Commander Edmonds about 2 days ago and had a conversation with him and asked him. And I was just like, you know, this isn't really for me. And he was like, ah, funny joke, Jeremy, you're always joking. And then he just hung up like he usually does. So, yeah, I think I'm kind of stuck.
Jeremy, I think you're just using... you always have that really sarcastic tone you always use there.
You're always joking, Jeremy.
You're always like... he might have just misunderstood. It just sounds like you're always joking, Jeremy. It's always sarcastic. Ha, Jeremy.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
All right, let's go do this job, Jeremy. You're always a hoot.
You guys get down to... You take the elevator just outside the bridge to the cargo hold... you exit the cargo hold, the crates are around you. There, the crate that you are going to be delivering is flashing. The drone comes around, picks it up, and sets it on the bare turntable in the center of the room where it would normally set it on a truck.
Set that on what? Sorry, I missed that.
It's just set onto the turntable. There's no truck underneath it.
Blake!
Jinx!
Where's the truck?
Truck will be finished next week, boys.
Well, how are we supposed to deliver this one?
I think this one's going to have to be by hand.
I don't remember there being anything about me having to lift heavy cargo.
How about no? Where's the truck at?
I could... If you just want to head to the workshop, I can show you the truck. Wow, why does Blake sound like this?
This is how Blake sounds in real life.
I'm going to go to the workshop.
In the workshop, you see the 3D printer about a third of the way done with the new truck.
I'm going to try to make it so that I'm going to overclock the 3D printer.
Okay. Go ahead.
That is going to be... A 9 plus 2. I'm imagining it's brains.
Yeah, so you...
11?
It's complete success. You fully overclock it. The truck is complete. Ready to be used on this mission. And Blake says, well, that is all of my processing power for the day. So I think you're on your own. But other than that, we're good to go.
Awesome. Sweet. And he gets in the truck.
The truck gets loaded underneath the cargo container, and the turntable goes up to the interbay room, and the steward gives you the signal as if you're ready.
Are we ready?
Are we, Jeremy?
No.
Why not?
Fine, let's just do it.
Great.
There's the spirit.
You give the steward the signal. You feel, well, you haven't experienced this yet. Your characters have not experienced the drop. So you feel your stomachs drop straight into your throat instead of the opposite direction. And when you land, it very quickly shoots straight out your asshole, and it feels like you are about to have uncontrollable diarrhea, but nothing comes. You are landed in the middle of a planet. It is complete darkness.
Can we do that again?
Eventually. All around you is nightlife. Casinos, bars, clubs, a whole bunch of stuff. You have landed in one giant parking lot just on the very edge. And there is a spaceport behind you guys. It's like an airport, but for spaceships. There is no... So you land in this parking lot. You are in the perfect parking spot when you land. And you are in this city.
Are we like, so by perfect parking spot, do you mean we're like kind of like over the line a little bit? So we're technically like taking up two spots?
It's two spots, but you got the Federation tags, so you're good to go.
Yeah, that's the ideal parking spot. is there any sort of like manifest to tell us like where we're supposed to take this?
You've got the data pad. So the data pad, it's actually a lot of information. It says that you are delivering this to the planet Los Los, which is your... You're familiar with Los Los. It is not in the middle of nowhere. It is a destination planet for the rich and powerful in the the core center of Federation planets. It is night all the time, so nightlife is a really big thing. You also know that Los Los has outlawed all wheeled vehicles. So every wheeled vehicle on the planet has to stay on this parking lot.
Are we in a wheeled vehicle?
Yeah.
You overclocked the 3D printer with the wheeled vehicle. Hey, Jeremy, I see why you said this would be quick. It just says we're supposed to deliver it to the planet. Job well done.
It continues to explain.
Okay. Well, if we're going by anything, I'm pretty sure that I just wanted to do this last time and you said no. And didn't we also establish that this truck can turn into a spaceship?
You can't fly a spaceship sub-horizon, or what is the word? Atmosphere? Like,
how are we going to steer it, Jeremy, around this is a crowded city?
Well, don't we have guns, too?
Jesus, Jeremy.
I just want to deliver this fucking package and go home.
Well, let's get carrying.
The manifest.
Can we use the drone?
You could. The manifest.
I'm asking Blake.
You could. The manifest says that the contents of the container need to be delivered to codename Raven. They are a deep undercover agent working here in Los Los at the Sulius Geezer Casino and Resort.
Sulius Geezer. Quoth the Raven evermore.
It's like an asshole.
Yeah, Sulius Geezer, huge asshole.
Well, Jeremy, you want to get this going? Let's go.
I'm going to watch the car.
Okay, Jeremy. And I start getting the drone ready to carry the cargo for me.
Cool. As you are getting the drone offloaded, the cargo container is offloaded, you start making your way out of the parking lot. You realize that the only exits out of this parking lot are, like, pedestrian-sized.
Oh, I can just walk out pedestrian, right?
You could walk out.
Yeah. I can't take the cargo with me, though?
No.
Oh. Well, I pushed the cargo back to the truck.
You push it, said, it lands, and you're like, why use a drone anymore?
Yeah. And I said, Jeremy, you watch the cargo. I'm going to go find this guy and tell him we have it.
Okay.
Great.
And I start... walking the streets towards the Sulius Geezer Resort Casino.
super fantastic. I'll tell you guys later. Okay, so the you start walking towards the Sulius Cheeser. We'll come back to you. So, Jeremy, while you're sitting in the cargo truck, just on the other side of the parking lot, you can see there's a bunch of people. They're walking on the street. You're just, like, just separated from the nightlife in this parking lot. On the other side, you see two people get into a small kerfuffle, and they spot you through the gate in the parking lot, and they come over to you, and they are at your passenger side window, and they give you a knock.
Oh, as soon as they start walking over to me, I'm going to be like, Blake, activate the guns.
I do not have room to deploy the weapons without causing imminent damage to the vehicles around us.
Did I fucking stutter?
Weapons deployed. When the weapons deploy, they actually go just above the vehicles around you. No damage is done.
Activate loudspeaker too, please. Thank you.
Everything you say can and will be heard by the people around you.
Yeah, you can just stop right there. Thanks. Turn around. Federation business.
You hear, they stop and they're like, oh, okay, dude, we just want to know if this was your money, but we'll
don't
find
care.
Somebody else.
No, please leave.
All right, have a great night, man. So sorry. So sorry. I don't know
yeah,
why.
You will be. Keep
this
on
is,
walking.
This is... As they're walking away, you overhear, conveniently enough, them saying, I wonder if he knows weapons are outlawed on this planet. And then they leave.
Wow, I don't know why I thought your name was David Blake. Blake, deactivate. Just
forever.
Reverse the last two things I told you to do.
Reversing the last two things. So we'll cut to Mickey. Mickey, you get to the row of hotels and casinos. There are an unfathomable amount of people, but it seems like a controlled chaos moving through the places. You, unfortunately, are just having the toughest time navigating this place. You keep running into folks. Give me a limber.
Yes, finally. I've been waiting to roll a die. Ching, baby. That's a 9 plus a 1, which is 10.
10, great. So you are walking down the street. You do not notice this guy at all, but kind of passively you hop out of his way. And he keeps pushing on down the street. He turns around and says, watch where you're going.
Watch yourself, bud.
Not your buddy guy.
You wanna come down here just walking around everybody else, nearly running into me and my family, and you're gonna start a fight with me here on the street?
I voted for Flump.
Your family has to be rather big for me to run them to them at the same time.
Holy shit, you did not just call my family fat. Holy shit.
You could say, some would say big boned, but that's just giving yourself a little too much credit there, isn't it, huh?
I didn't think we were going to get in a fight here when you rolled a 10, but here we go. So the dude takes off, he's wearing a full suit. He takes off the coat, unbuttons his shirt sleeves and rolls them up, and gives you that classic boxer, put him up.
Mickey actually just turns around and starts walking away from him.
That's a choice. That's a choice that you made. And you can make any choice you want in this game. Roll a fights.
Yeah, I figured. I figured I wasn't going to be able to just walk out of this. This is just what Mickey would try to do. Six. Plus zero.
So that
marks
is
failure.
A failure. Well, no, it's I think 1 to 4 is what we say is a fail.
1 to 6.
Oh, is it?
I don't know why I have 1 to 4 here. One to six.
I thought it was
1 to 9.
Yeah, 1 to 6, 7 to 9. You wanted it more likely to fail, so.
Yep.
Mark experience, big guy.
Get that experience, though. You fail, but you take, or you fail and you take just the full force of this guy's fist to the base of your skull. And then you hit the ground, you take 2 damage. I don't know. Yeah, we'll call that 2 damage. Unarmed strike. You are out cold on the sidewalk. Jeremy, you are sitting in the truck still. You see, oh, you don't know who that is. So in front of you is a, like, the same place where these two folks were. You just happen to catch a towering figure over the crowd, of a dude dressed in, like, pirate regalia with a very large gray beard as he is moving down the street of Las.
Graybeard again?
Hey, Blake.
Hello!
It's been a little while. You think you could maybe, like, is there any way you could, like, get a hold of Mickey's communicator and, like, see where he's at?
Patching you through now! It just rings. Still ringing. I could not complete that call as dialed. Please hang up and try again.
You try one more time?
It just rings.
Is there any way that you can, like, tell me where he's at?
Mickey hasn't moved for some time. It looks like he is stopped in the middle of the street for some reason.
Blake?
Hello?
What do you do when you're supposed to do something, but you really don't want to do it?
I'm not programmed to not want. I always want. Give me some.
It's like programmed not that want.
Blake?
Yes?
Are you patched to the ship right now?
Sure am.
Do you think starting tomorrow you could start, like, whipping up a truck that doesn't have wheels and just floats?
Yeah, I would need your help with that, but I would love to get your help with that.
I would love to give you my help with that. You do one more thing for me?
Absolutely.
Just open up the container.
I can't do that.
You can't?
You're going to need that data pad that Mickey left on the seat right next to you, and you can open the container.
Fine. And he goes and opens up the container.
Great, you do that, and in the center of the container, on a like a marble pedestal under a glass bell jar on a little stand, is a poker chip. It's rather large, and it is black and gold. But other than that, looks just like a poker chip.
He reaches into his over. I imagine he's wearing, like, coveralls, and he, like, pulls out some work gloves, puts them on, picks it up, puts it in the middle pocket of his overalls, and he's like, Blake?
Yes?
Can you start leading me to where he is, where Mickey is, please?
It looks like Mickey is making his way to the Coolius Caesar, or wait, Coolius Caesar Hotel Resort and Casino. I assume you start heading in that direction.
Yeah, wherever he's, like, been, I know that he's laying, but wherever he hasn't been moving for a while.
Great. So Mickey, when you come to, you're being drugged down a hallway indoors. Your family background, you've spent a lot of time in hotels, and your background, you've spent a lot of time, like, running around the back hallways of hotels when you weren't supposed to. So you recognize this as, like, a back hotel corridor, like, for the staff to be moving with ease throughout the building. You kind of fade in and out of consciousness, and when you finally come all the way through, you are tied to a chair, and there is a dude standing in front of you. He is very tall, very slender, and he has a bird in the corner of the room that is also very large. It says, he grabs your forehead and pushes back and says, who you working for?
What do you mean?
I know what ship you came in on. You're not Cal or Eve. Who are you working for?
Cal or Eve? I have no idea who you're talking about. Clearly you must be mistaken. I am here for purely entertainment reasons. I mean, I guess I work in an accounting firm, if that's what you're asking, but I don't know why you need to know that.
accounting firm. Your ID says here you're Mickelson. Lieutenant Mickelson's nephew, probably?
I mean, yes, my uncle is in the Federation as the lieutenant, but I just work at an accounting firm.
Your Federation ID.
Yeah, I mean, you have to have a guest ID to visit my uncle.
So, this ID is in this wallet, and it says, Mickey Mickelson belongs...
This is your wallet. Yeah. Sounds about right.
It's not my wallet. Oh, dude, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have tried to lie to you. I nicked that off a guy earlier in the street.
It's your photo ID. Roll yeah. A tox, trying to convince this guy that you are not Mickey Mickelson.
Roll the 5.
Do you add 2 to that, perchance?
No, I that was a 4 plus 1.
Great. So he's like, this is a photo ID. It says Federation Troop. member of the Federation, Mickey Mickelson.
Really weird. I don't remember receiving that ID, actually. But...
You lie worse than any kid on TikTok. All right. Well, if you're not gonna give me any information, then I guess I'll just follow you. And you are knocked out cold, just like fist to the face.
Don't take any more damage.
No. It's a controlled hit. So
I just like my head goes back, and I'm like. Compared to the last hit, that hit was weak.
Coming back to Jeremy, Blake says, you're standing in front of the coolest geezer hotel, resort, and casino. As you're standing in the front, Blake says, it looks like Mickey's made his way inside.
When did he start moving again?
Right about the time you picked up the chip.
Huh. Well, let's go try and find this raven.
Soon as you walk in, there is someone standing to the left of, like, the hotel clerk area. They're matching the exact physical description of the raven on the dossier, and they give you just, like, 2 fingers as they start walking over to the hotel bank, or the elevator bank. They push a button and wait there.
Oh, also, I would like to note that it took Mickey a while to get here, but I like to think that... Jeremy got there a little bit faster because he's used to being not noticed, so he passes through crowds a lot easier.
Than
normal
sure.
people.
That
and
definitely
he's also like half the size of a normal human, so he just
you 100% got here way faster than Mickey. It almost looked like people were moving around you to give you space
because there's a fucking bear in the middle of the street.
It definitely wasn't like a conscious decision by anyone. No one was like, "Holy shit, a bear!" Like people just gave you a little bit of room.
He heads over to the Raven.
Cool. The Raven gets inside the elevator and seems to be, or they put their hand out and hold it, expecting you to get on.
Remind me of somebody I saw last night. He walks onto the, I'm talking about the steward.
She laughs. Like the funniest joke she's ever heard. Elevator doors close. Mickey, you wake up in that room again. There is nobody there. There is no sign that anybody has been there, and you are no longer restrained to the chair.
Oh, nice. Do I feel well rested at this point? I've been knocked out twice.
Nope.
I'm gonna get out of the chair and leave the room.
Yeah, sure. You leave the room. You are in a back hallway. You can hear like hustling and bustling on the other side of like the wall. You have no idea where you are. Like, to the left is a long corridor, to the right is a long corridor.
2 questions.
In the middle with you.
I check my pockets. Do I still have my ID?
You have been completely looted. You have nothing.
I don't have my gun or anything. Okay.
Do you brought your gun?
Shoot. Well, yeah, I didn't know it was illegal on this planet.
You have your gun.
Okay. He looted everything but my gun. Sweet dude.
He took all of your identifying information.
I'm gonna go take a look around and see if I can find and recognize the guy who just was interrogating me.
Cool. So you just kind of wander around aimlessly. You find a door to walk through, and you are on the casino floor. It is big. They're playing space casino games. There's stuff with bubbles. It's cool. There's a live band. They're like do.
Jizz.
I love jizz. That's the worst part of those movies, that he named Jazz Jizz. Some things just don't need to change. There could be space jazz, man. Anyways. You are on the main floor of the casino. As you're kind of walking around, you notice that the tables you walk by, they're losing. Like, without fail. As you walk past, they lose. As you're kind of, like, moving about, I don't know if you necessarily attribute your presence to them losing, but you notice that people are losing around you. Just kind of like, we'll say like your fifth table that you walk past, there's this card game going on. One of the dudes stands up, turns to walk away from the table after losing a big hand, lots of money on the table, and he runs right into you, just knocks you straight flat on your back.
I seem to keep falling on my flat on my ass this
time. It's the same guy.
It's the guy from outside. He's like, I cannot believe you were here. And he starts rolling up his sleeves. He says, what do you got to say for yourself this time, buddy?
Wait, is it actually the same guy? It
is now.
I get up and start brushing myself off, and I say, I reach out my hand and say, sorry about earlier. I was in a little bit of a rush. Does he take my hand?
Yeah. He reaches his hand out.
And when he takes my hand, I pull him in, I take my blaster out, and I pull it in close, and I said, you better leave me alone and walk away right now. And never talk to me again.
Abe, I'm gonna have you roll, you're not shooting, so we won't call it a shoots. We will call it, it's either fights or limber. I think since you're initiating, we'll call it a fights.
I'm really good at fights. Okay, I rolled a 9.
9, cool. So you do easy peasy, you pull that guy in, you pull your weapon out. He looks down at your weapon, grabs it with his free hand, strips it. Just completely strips and hands you 3 pieces. It's just like lightning fast speed. Says, looks like you got a spot of bad luck, buddy. And then he pushes you back and walks away.
I'm going to reassemble my gun real quick.
For whatever reason, you just can't get the pieces back together.
Huh.
One of the screws is stripped.
So you cut back to the Raven. You have been riding the elevator for some time. You get to your floor, it dings, and you are on the penthouse. You're at the top of the coolest cheeser. There is a dude sitting at the head of the table with a big gray beard and pirate regalia. The Raven says, our package has been delivered. And she kind of puts her hand behind on your back and leads you into the room.
His tail starts wagging. I'm just supposed to give this to you. I'm just trying to give this to you and leave. Let me be honest. I'm in like way over my head here, and I don't know if you're gonna like kill me or something, but like, I just want to just give you this and leave.
The Greybeard, it's Greybeard, rises to his feet and says,
wait, so I would have recognized him then if it's the same guy.
What? Greybeard isn't the Raven.
I know, Greybeard, the one that's sitting at the table?
Yeah.
And I saw him in the crowd earlier?
Yeah.
I would know who that was.
Yeah, you know it's Greybeard.
You told me it wasn't. You said I wouldn't recognize him.
I was going to have you run into the marshal and then change my mind. Sorry. You wouldn't know who the marshal is by sight. So yeah,
you said, oh, you wouldn't know who the marshal is. And then you described Greybeard to me. So
yeah, I know earlier when you said Greybeard, I changed my mind. Greybeard is in front of you. I thought seeing Greybeard was the only reason you got out of the truck. I'm sorry.
No, I never would have left the truck if any Greybeard was here.
Fun fact, Greybeard's here, and he's directly in front of you. He stands up, gestures to an empty seat, and says, why don't you join me for a meal, and then I'll get you on your way.
Is there a window?
You're thousands of feet in the air.
Yeah, I know.
The elevator ride is like 10 minutes.
Character.
Yeah, just from
a plan.
From a quick assessment, you don't think any of the windows open, so you'll have to try to throw yourself through one of them if you would like to escape that way.
Greybeard.
Yes.
What do you do when you have to do something but you really don't want to?
I have a meal and think about it first. Why don't you join me for dinner?
Raven? What do you do? Raven wakes up with longing eyes.
Raven sits down at the table and starts enjoying a nice meal.
Okay. I am a little hungry.
What is it?
What do you make?
He didn't make it, but it looks like some sort of game bird from room service. Looks delicious. Like, just the best. Some game bird, some collard greens, maybe. I don't know. Does that go well with game bird? Oh, I guess what they say about you is true. You're a literal bear. All right. Oh. All right.
Just Jeremy.
I imagine Fantastic Mr. Fox, like he just ate
Greybeard sits back down at the head of the table, and while you're eating, he doesn't eat. You finish eating, he says, so I figure by now you know something's up. You're not stupid, Jeremy.
Not funny either, but everybody seems to keep thinking that too. So.
Oh, Jeremy, you crack me up. The relic, Jeremy. I would like the relic. You could give it to Raven, but I would like to take it from Raven. I just want you to know that I'm gonna take the relic after you complete the delivery, and maybe we could cut out the middleman next time.
How do you keep showing up? How do you know where we're going?
I'm the.
What's your deal?
I'm the biggest thorn in the Federation side. I've made powerful friends and even more powerful enemies. They tell me.
What do
these
you know
things.
About Commander Edmonds?
I know Commander Edmonds isn't all that they advertise themselves to be. That's for sure.
Yeah. No shit.
Jeremy, you've got the relic.
He reaches into his overalls, and it looks like he's going for the relic, but instead, he reaches in deeper, like inside. And he pulls out a book.
Oh.
This is the diary of a man named Cal Cordis.
You see the Greybeard and Raven look at each other, and they say, what would you want for something like that?
I didn't know you were going to offer me something. Give me just a second. I just want to know what I'm doing here. Like, what is this?
Jeremy, you're making deliveries. That's all it has to be. Who needs...
Yeah, but deliveries are easy. This is not easy.
This looks like a pretty big cakewalk to me, Jeremy. You got a free meal, you sit in the penthouse of one of the greatest hotels in all the Federation.
Yeah, but there's always something. I've only done this twice. And I have a feeling that something crazy is going to happen every time.
Jeremy.
It's like there's somebody looking down on us that just wants us to get into these weird adventures.
It's crazy how the cosmos work like that, huh, Jeremy? I think right now you're in for a spot of good luck. So, you ask me any question, I'll answer it as honestly as I can, if I know the truth, how I know the truth to be. Granted, doesn't mean I haven't been lied to.
Let's start with who Cal Cordis is and why his diary is on the ship that I work on right now. in a room that was supposed to be blown out.
Yeah.
That looks completely fine.
Calcourt has had the job before you. Before I knew about the mission, Calcourtus and his co-captain Eve the Empath, they were...
Is that her full title? Was that like...
Yeah, Eve the Empath. ETE. Okay. The, truth of the matter is,
I'm very sweet.
I don't know what happened to Cal, but, I know something happened on that ship that resulted in him and Eve being out, and you and Mickey being in. And I also know that I got a lot of information around the same time from a mysterious source. And it keeps coming. I'm not saying it's Cal, but I wouldn't be surprised.
You have the transponder codes?
Ah, that's the thing, Jeremy. It's messages in a bottle. They come to me in space. They peer on our Doppler, we pull them in with a tractor beam, and we open them. They tell us where to be, where to meet you, and what the relic is.
The fuck? Okay, well, what do you know about Commander Edmonds?
Just about nothing.
I mean, I'm gonna be completely honest. I've never met a talking cat alien before, and I know that I'm completely, like, not supposed to be... I know there's nothing else like me out there, but,
They react, when you say that. They look at each other and say, are you sure about that?
Things like me?
Yeah.
What? No, fuck, yeah, I know there's, like, brown bears and polar bears, but, like, there's none that can, like, talk.
No, from the place you came from. You sure there's nowhere more? There's none more of you? You're not aware of anymore.
You know something I don't, Graybeard?
He leans back in his chair, and he says, well, I guess at some point he'd find out, but I thought I'd have to use it in more of a threatening manner, but now I'm curious. Now I want to get to the bottom of this mystery. Come on in. And he gestures to a door at the other side of the room, and it opens, and it's Darth Vader.
You my blaster at him.
Entering into the room is roughly the same height as you are, a sentient duck. Do you or don't you recognize him?
I would say, like, subconsciously, yes. Like, maybe he has, like, a flashback.
Cool. Give me that flashback. When was the last time... What is that memory for you and Agent D?
So they look a little bit younger. Like, it's hard to tell because they kind of are... They're animals, so it's tough to tell, but... They're currently fighting in what looks to be like an all-black room with a giant gym, all black, with like one light on it, and there's like a window at like the top, like presumably with people watching them, and this duck is using a pair of nunchucks like you've never seen before,
with his webbed feet.
With his webbed feet, exactly. Yeah.
Literally never seen anything like.
And the flashback comes in, and he's like, and like, Jeremy falls to the ground, and this duck is just like,
maybe next time, huh, Jake?
You keep going. Is that it? Is that the memory?
He gets up and he goes, yeah, whatever. This isn't my department, anyways. We both know that you were bred to be a good fighter.
I was bred to be the very best of them all, Jay. someday you'll see nobody will beat me. And then, unless you have something else you want to add to this memory.
Ick. And he walks out.
You walk out. That's the last time you saw him. You walked out of the facility at that point. So as you walk out the door, Agent D walks in the door and he says, Jay, my old friend. Oh... I don't think I get you today, but no, I'm coming for you.
Is there a window in this room?
It's the same windows. No openings.
He fucking runs towards the window.
So, Agent, pause. Let's check in with Mickey. Mickey, you have been tossed to the ground, beaten up, thrown around, just repeatedly, over and over and over again.
Thinking about quitting this job.
Yeah, it's a good call. You're currently standing in the lobby of the hotel. Mickey's having a rough day. Yes. While you're standing in the lobby, two uniformed police officers enter the lobby and they walk right up to you and they say, "Are you Mickey Mickelson?"
No.
He doesn't have an ID.
Can we see some?
No, I don't have an ID.
Do you happen to have any ID on you?
I had some earlier this morning, and it got stolen from me.
See, this guy here. Whoop.
Oh.
No, go ahead. Please incriminate yourself.
Well, no, what were you about to say?
No, it's fine. You seem like you had something important you wanted to say there.
I plead the 143rd right that I have.
Oh, you kids today thinking you know what matters. This guy over here says that you tried to arrest him earlier. And it's the dude. It's the guy that you held a gun to just a couple of minutes ago. Says you pulled a gun on him. Said that if he doesn't leave you alone, you're going to fuck him up. Take him to jail.
I said no such thing.
I think we're going to
earlier I ran into him and he handed me three pieces of a gun and I didn't know what to do with them. It was like 3 minutes ago. I'd like to turn them in now. I know we're not supposed to have weapons on this planet.
They take your gun. They're like, listen,
go,
he's trying to incriminate me earlier because earlier he ran into me and started insulting me and I may have insulted his family. I tried to apologize to him earlier and give him a handshake and then he handed me three pieces of gun and threw me to the ground. He's trying to incriminate me.
Connor, do you jump out the window?
Yep.
Give me a fight. You're fighting the window.
He also, like, I guess he, as he's running, like, maybe he pulls out, like a spanner that he has, like, to try and, like, hit it as he's going out.
I'll let you do it with the relic.
Yeah.
Cool.
That is a 10.
Great. Easily.
Yeah, I don't have any fights yet.
Even easier. You burst through the window, and you are now free falling to your death. Thoughts? Yes.
I need you right now. I need you right now. Turn the ship and pick me up now.
What? What did you just ask?
Bring the truck. Turn it into a ship and pick me up now.
Okay. Just in the nick of time, just before you hit the ground, the truck pulls in sideways and you fall into the other side.
I just perfect. Into my Iron Man suit.
Just full repulsor 5 feet Wait, from the ground.
I think there should be a liberal right now if Jeremy lives or dies.
That there would be if Jeremy wasn't carrying the relic.
I just want to say I love this episode. I really like the idea of this episode. We haven't finished it yet, but I fucking love it.
There is a so Mickey, in the hotel lobby, there is like, it sounds like something just hit the speed of sound and stopped very fast. So two very quick booms, and the second one being much closer to the hotel. Stuff shakes and falls off. The two cops that are interrogating you, they run off outside to see what is going on.
I turn to the guy who's tried to arrest me. Maybe my luck's finally turned, asshole.
You turn around and run into a pole.
Perfect.
As you make your way, kind of dancing, I guess, out of the room, you see the truck is illegally parked in front of the Coolius Geezer. Just like in the middle of a bunch of pedestrians, Jeremy T-Bear is sitting there waving.
I pretend like I do not see him waving at me. I just start like whistling and like strolling through the crowd a little bit.
Cool. So you ignore your way out of here.
Wait, call Mickey.
Will do. So Mickey, your phone starts ringing. Your wrist starts ringing.
I answer it for once in my life.
Mickey, This is Blake. I'm patching you through to Jeremy now.
Oh, okay, sounds good.
Mickey?
Yes, Jeremy.
You guys are staring at each other.
Yeah, just looking at each other like this at our wrists.
This delivery is compromised.
Yeah, and it seems like you're kind of compromised right now.
Graybeard is here.
Graybeard?
I have so many things I need to tell you.
Well, we should probably work on getting out of here first. You're kind of illegally parked in essentially what's the Las Vegas Strip.
That's it'll be fine. You know, let me work my magic with the cops. And you see him get out of the car and start walking towards the police officers.
Cool. As you do that, A-okay, perfectly fine. Mickey, what is your reaction? What are you doing?
I'm going to start creeping towards the truck as he talks to the cops.
Cool. We don't even need to talk to the cops. We just know Jeremy is talking to the cops and it's going very, very well.
He is going to inform them that there's a wanted fugitive on the top of the top floor penthouse.
Yeah, so that...
That's
perfect.
That's the main focus.
That is the last thing you say to them for whatever reason. The Mickey makes it back to the truck. As you are sitting there...
As they start to run off, he goes... Tell Cynthia I said hi. And then he, like, gets into the truck. He's like, yeah, let's get out of here.
Cool. So you say that to them, and as you turn around, you see somebody else get in the driver's seat of the car, shut it, and lock it with Mickey and him inside there.
Blake, hey, that's not me.
I'm aware. I don't want this guy in my front seat either.
Well, get rid of him then.
That's up to Mickey. The guy sits in and he hands you your ID and says, so you want to start talking now, or?
Are you going to sit here and pretend like you're some sort of awesome sleuth who followed me?
The door and is, like, looking right outside the
yep, just staring in the window while this conversation just happened.
Just the guy looks over, his eyes are, like, just there. I say to the guy, it's like, you're just going to, like, act like you're some sort of brilliant sleuth because you followed me the one building I went into? Thanks for the idea back, though.
So I just want to be clear. This is not the dude who's been giving you gruff all night. This is the guy
The dude that who said he was going to follow me instead later and punched me out in the interrogation room. Yeah, that's why I said, you think you're some sleuth for following me through the one building I've been in?
Look, I just need to figure out what's going on here, and you seem to be my best bet. So
why me? I've been completely, because
you're
like...
on the arc.
Oh, cool. Well, who are you? Maybe if you give me some answers, I'd be more willing to give you some.
He leans back and takes out his ID, and it says Erickson Thurgood. He has former credentials. He hands to you as well and says, "This is who I used to be," and it's he used to be a Federation Marshal. They don't seem to be wearing any insignia to make you think that they are currently still a Federation Marshal.
Why should I trust you?
I don't know. I'm trusting you. I punched you a little bit, so you don't need
to
trust me.
You're not really trusting me. You're kind of just like demanding answers and punching me. Like, why should I give you any of my answers? That you want.
Right. That's a very fair position, Mickey.
It is.
I know something's up. I just want you to give me. Hold on. I just want you to give me.
Can I turn on the intercom system at any point?
I will let you do that. Yes.
Okay.
So this is all being broadcast now.
The entire audience.
The entire strip. Yes. I just need. I just need you to take this meeting if it ever happens again. I'm going to go.
Take what?
If I come to you again, I don't want to have to punch you out to get your attention.
It seems you can just, like, enter whatever room I'm in or truck I'm in at any time, so it doesn't seem like you really needed to.
the names.
Doesn't seem. Let me put it like this. It doesn't seem like I have a choice whether I want to talk to you or not. So,
you never know what it goes. How the next encounter will be. I found you this time. Next time, I will make myself apparent, and I will have information for you. You can come get it, or you cannot. And he gets out of the truck.
Oh, okay.
Jeremy, have a good day.
Does he hit Jeremy away. With the door as he opens it?
No, not right even close. There. No, not even close. Oh, yeah, that's very right. Respectful for Jeremy.
Yeah, hey, wait a second.
He turns and looks down.
Wait a second, sir. You can know my name, but I can't know yours? That seems a little rude.
Former Federation Marshal Erickson Thurgood. And he walks away.
Nice to meet you. Hey, Blake, shut off the intercom. And he says that just loud enough so that Marshal can hear.
He just keeps walking. It doesn't bug him at all.
He seems nice.
Good guy.
I mean, he punched me out earlier, but sure.
He hit you for no damage. The other
he
guy
knocked me out. Wait, do I hear a voice? It's like
Blake is Cosmo who comes down.
He hit you for no damage.
So you guys are illegally parked, but the cops are distracted. Somebody just gave him a tip that there is a incredibly wanted fugitive. Mickey has 5 visible goose eggs on his head.
There's at least 6.
So nobody is coming to like stop. In fact, most people are just moving around the car. They think it's part of like the loss atmosphere.
Mickey, have you ever been in love before?
Holy shit.
I asked myself the same question one time. Sometimes there was this one person.
Yeah.
Fade I ask myself black. Every day if it really was love.
Who was it?
That guy you just saw.
I don't know if I quite want to get into it, Jeremy. It's kind of a long story.
Oh.
And it's really emotional to me, but
he rolls down the window and like looks out and then like rolls it back up again and goes, "Well, traffic's kind of heavy."
That's very good. I'm going to make Abe tell the story.
Well. Name was Dave, Jeremy.
Abe.
Yeah.
Is it awkward because he was also a bear? Or?
No. I've always, I've never been a big fan of bears. I don't, no offense, Jeremy. I'm fine with you, but I've had a lot of issues with bear because I had this teddy that I really liked when I was a kid, and my father thought it was making me too soft. So he took it away from me and burned it in front of me. Made me watch from my bedroom window while he burned it in the yard. So I guess kind of in front of me, and I've had a really big issue with bears ever since. So actually working with you has really helped me cope with it, or start to at least. But
that's awesome, but tell me more about this Dave.
So, Dave and me were Academy sweethearts. We met in the Academy, is what I should say.
I would love them.
But again, my bastard father. You'll come to learn that most of my emotional issues stem from my bastard father. I fucking hate that guy.
Oh, he was born out of wedlock. That sucks.
You're a good one, Jeremy.
Yeah.
Dave was kind of a rebel and didn't really like the Federation too much. My path was always to be in the Federation because of my uncle, as you know, he's a lieutenant. So Dave kind of pulled God, I miss that guy. Kind of pulled a really fun prank where he replaced all of the Academy professors' ink with invisible ink that he made out of his own piss. And then dropped out. And my father thought he was a really bad influence, so he had him sent off to just looking at AJ's face, sorry. He had him shift off to a disciplinary planet because he kind of had that power, you know, the connections in the Federation. And I haven't seen him since. Ooh. And it's hurt every day. It really has. So thank you for bringing up that painful memory, Jeremy.
Oh, shit. Oh, fuck. Blake, could you really turn off the intercom this time?
Very funny, awesome. Jeremy. Always with the joke.
No, like, it's the bad luck thing. Like...
Yeah.
Yep. Hey, Connor, you're right. That intercom turned on halfway through that.
Also, out of character comment for future reference, I just noticed this because Dwin, I don't know why I said Dwin.
Dwin
posted in the chat, and I see that you put it there. Mickey's without an E.
No E. Okay, MICKY.
Yeah.
Hey, Mickey, you're so fine. You're so fine. You blow my mind.
Yeah.
MIOCK. Okay.
MIO.
I will not fix it.
That's okay. It's part of my bad luck, so.
All right, so we're done. Blake pops up and says, should I take us back to the ship?
But we didn't finish the delivery.
This delivery's been compromised.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, let's go back to the ship.
Wait, why did I tell you about that story about Dave when you had a whole story to tell me about why the mission was compromised?
Preparing ship transport. Boop! And the exact opposite feeling, where you feel like you can't not shit, and then all of a sudden you feel like you can't not vomit, and then you're chill. As you are in the interbay, in the truck, on the turntable, the steward gives you a wave and says, how did it go?
So, you know,
not great.
It was pretty dope.
Steward.
I don't think I've ever felt that alive before.
I know we've only done two missions now, but have you ever asked that question to the employees and had a good answer come out of it?
Actually, the last ones, they didn't answer. Oh. I mean,
the last ones.
Oh, Mickey, you're so funny. And then she disappears. She just goes down the hallway towards the bridge.
You mean, oh, Mickey, you're so fine, right? Missed opportunity.
She says, why don't you follow me to the bridge? We'll tell Commander Edmonds that we have completed this mission.
Kind of.
Hey, let's just...
Kind of.
He's just joking.
It
was weird because we had to, like, walk it through the street. And instead of, like, so, like, the cargo container's still, like, in the parking lot, technically.
Plus, I lost some money at the gambling table, so I didn't really feel like I completed the mission, you know?
Yeah,
I felt like I really lost out.
Sounds about right! And then she continues her way to the bridge. I'm going to let you two chat about how this is going to go while I go get another drink. I'll be right back.
Jeremy, what are we going to tell him?
Let's just...
I don't even know what happened, so...
There's just not a lot to know. It's just more so, like, Greybeard is getting messages from somebody that is telling him where to be to intersect us. And
that makes it tough, Jeremy.
He's got a friend, somebody I know. And, oh, wow, would you look at that? It's the bridge, and he walks it.
Commander Edmonds pops up and says, how did it go?
Fantastic.
Fantastic. You could just slide that data pad in there, Mickey, and we will get rolling.
Mickey slides it in, and then reaches up as if he's going to give Jeremy a high five and turns it into a fist bump.
Oh, shit.
The data pad's accepted. Excellent job, folks. Another mission complete. Are you ready for the next one? Anything I could help you with? Anything weird on that one?
Oh, well, question. No. Yeah, and question. Since there was no mishaps and nothing weird happened this time, any chance of a bonus? Clean, well-accomplished mission?
Mickey, I think you know better than to ask for a bonus on your second mission. Oh, man. What a spot of bad luck you find yourself in.
You can't blame me for trying.
I'm actually going to have to demote you for insubordination.
Oh, okay.
I'm docking your pay.
Does that make me, does that make me, commanding officer?
No, you guys are equal rank, but Jeremy, you're now getting paid Mickey's salary. The part
you,
I deducted.
You said you demoted me, which means that before this point right here, Jeremy, I was the lead, and we just got demoted to equals.
Well, that makes sense. Commander Edmonds.
Yes.
I was, doing some reading in Loss, the place that we visited.
Yeah.
And read something about a former Marshal Erickson Thurgood in the papers. It said that he worked on this project briefly, and I was just wondering what happened to him.
Erickson Thurgood was a marshal in my personal employ that went rogue. Any materials you have with him in it, well, they're probably illegal. I would imagine you picked up some smut off the street down there in Loss.
Yeah, it wasn't a very nice place.
Yeah. Erickson Thurgood is, if you ever spot them, you have my permission to terminate with extreme force. Ooh. You have the Federation's permission.
What? Why?
Permission too?
They're a traitor.
Do we just kill every merchant we find then?
Every merchant? I would not do that.
Well, you said we're supposed to kill them because they're a traitor.
With a T, my guy.
Oh, shoot. Thanks for clarifying. I was about to just start shooting willy-nilly.
Don't shoot willy or nilly. They
also,
are.
Could I possibly get a gun? I lost mine on the last mission, I guess, because it got taken away by the cops because I didn't realize I wasn't supposed to have one on the planet. I didn't read the data pad early enough.
Mickey, you can have a gun if you can afford it.
Wow.
I don't know what that means. I'm sorry. That's what came
up. You just want me to be undefended on our next mission? I'm hauling pretty important cargo here. You think you'd want me to have a weapon?
The truck's
good. Can I roll talks on that?
Yeah, go ahead. Hit me.
I got an 8. 7 plus 1.
Yeah, I'm sure we could get you something, probably. Hey, Blake, can we get Mickey some sort of melee weapon here?
Melee weapon? I need a gun, dude. That's what I specialize in.
Yeah, well, spot of bad luck, isn't it? If you folks need anything else, I will see you next week.
Commander Edmonds, one more thing.
Yeah.
Sorry to bother you on such a personal question, but have you ever been in love?
I'm just leave right now.
Jeremy, you're right. That is too personal, but I don't know. I'm just getting a good vibe from you today. I kind of want to chat with you. Yeah, I was in love. Once. His name was David. A friend of mine locked him up for some time. I haven't been able to talk to him for a while, but I think about him every day. If I could, I would use my power to get him out, but you know, I can't. It hurts.
Mickey is looking super suspiciously at.
I hope you wouldn't mind doing a favor for me then, Commander Edmund. If this is too much to ask, I understand, but the personnel that we dropped the package off to today, her name was the Raven. I was just wondering if you could just, I don't know, get me some information on her so I can maybe try to slide into them DMs, if you know what I'm saying.
Well, consent is incredibly important, Jeremy. I'm actually going to follow up with Raven about this delivery after I get off the phone with you guys. I will make sure it's okay to pass her information along to you. So, I'll be, I'm in your corner.
Thank you.
Anything else? All right, bye, Mickey. Have a good night, Jeremy. Click.
Bye. What do you think is going to happen when he asks Raven?
Okay. That's not good. he runs into the refugee hotel. He'd rather take his chances with the ghosts.
You are great at the refugee hotel. It's actually the most you've enjoyed yourself in there.
This is a good question that we need to have answered from Wynn. Is Jeremy okay? Why is he so hung up on this love thing?
I think Jeremy just has a thing for the Raven.
Fair.
I don't know. For whatever reason, when AJ started describing it, I was like, it'd be really funny if Jeremy was just like in love with this woman.
Cool.
So,
yeah.
He's never really felt love before, so he's kind of just figuring it out.
So yeah, love at first sight, quite literally. You're in the dorm, like common. Well, no, sorry. You're in the refugee hotel. You've stated that. Mickey, you're back there with him. How much are you telling? What did you catch him up on everything that happened in Sky
City?
Yeah, I'll
catch him up on everything that happened. I will leave out the part of specifically about the duck.
You're not telling him about the duck. Great, cool.
Not gonna tell him about Agent D. But he like it. I imagine like he it ends up and like he has like he pulls the chip out to show that he still has it in his overalls. So then he like tucks it back in.
Cool.
Oh, he also doesn't talk about the diary. He doesn't bring up the diary, which he still has.
Oh, wild. Yeah, you didn't give that up. I
got all that information for free, baby.
Yeah, and you just jumped out the hotel. Yeah. And you've got a relic. Okay,
pretty
so
good luck.
While you're chatting in the back, the steward enters and we'll say you're discussing the relic when she comes in. Are you cluing her in?
Nope.
So you,
oh no no no
hide the relic
no, no.
All that okay cool
in fact when she comes in Jeremy's gonna be like oh Stuart just the person I was looking for you know I was actually thinking about this just the other night I just thinking maybe you need a little bit of like just like a routine maintenance I don't think I've done it since I got here and it's been a few weeks and I think it'd be nice for me to just you know check up on you and make sure everything looks nice
Jeremy. I would appreciate that. We can schedule that for tonight, if that's all right with you.
Of course.
Fantastic. I do wish to inform you that I guess something just came through the interbay. It's not sentient, but it is a message, I suppose?
In a bottle?
Yeah, glass bottle. Corked. And that's where we're going to end it for this week.
It's running.
So, that's going to be this week's Cosmo Cosmic Bang Bang. I am curious to see how this relic's going to play out, because I don't know if you figured it out yet, but while you're holding it, you have good luck. And yep. if you're the last person to, like, walk away from it, you've got bad luck. I should have told you that, but,
I figured it out. I think my character might die next episode if it keeps seeing a thing like
we'll gamify
it's
it.
Just,
we'll
it's
call
really
it
fun to have everything you do automatically fail. it's really fun, guys.
We'll gamify it. We'll give you like disadvantage.
This episode. I don't know what you're talking about.
I think we'll figure out a way to get rid of the curse. So you've got for next week a message in the bottle in the interbay. Mickey is just mad. He's got six goose. Mickey's concussed.
actually win. Since the last time we spoke about it, a seventh one just randomly appeared.
Well, is concussions have concussions? Folks, I see a few people in here that haven't followed us. We do this every week, generally on Thursday nights, and Wednesday is a variety show. That will happen tomorrow night, so come on down. Join us tomorrow if you haven't followed me. Please? I would appreciate it. Other than that, this has been our first affiliate stream. Do you guys feel like big boys and big britches?
I feel like I know a big boy.
Yeah, I know a big boy with big britches.
I don't know if I think affiliate gets you like preference in like search queues, and it definitely felt like it tonight. Like, we stayed above 5 viewers for most of the show, so that is I appreciate everybody who watched tonight. Thank you so much. Come back tomorrow for the Wednesday show.
And before we go,
yes,
me and Connor's Twitches are both also linked in the description if you guys want to give us a follow.
Please do. We're trying to build something together here, so
yeah.
Helping all three of us helps me. And if you've already helped me, you want to help all three of us. Other than that, folks, I will see you tomorrow night for the Wednesday show, and then we'll be back on Monday for the Ampersand Hour on Abe's channel. I hope you all have a lovely, lovely, lovely week.
Thanks for coming, guys. Love you.